Hello, good morning. Good morning. I'm Kate Silverton. Welcome. I'm a broadcaster and journalist, as you may know, and I'm delighted to be your host today for this, the Grant Thornton Managing Today, Planning for Tomorrow virtual event on the topic of redefining value. We know that the past 12 months have really seen a paradigm shift in how investors perceive and measure the value they place upon a business, and business leaders are inevitably asking if there has been a fundamental shift now in appraising value. So that's what we're going to look at today. In the next hour, I'll be joined by an expert panel. They'll be sharing their experiences of how value has changed and their vision of what it will look like in the future. So we've got 15 minutes at the end. I would really encourage you, this is for you, so I want to make it as interactive as possible. So do please send in your questions at any time throughout the event. Don't just wait until the end, because we can gather them up and get through as many as we can. You can do that via the chat window on the right side of your screen. If you want to direct a question to a specific speaker, then do add their name with your question. We're used to this by now, of course, but I'm sitting here in half office, half playroom. Magnetic tiles might fall on me at some point or whatever. We all know that we might have unplanned interruptions with technology, children, dogs, or deliveries or whatever. So we all bear with each other in that regard. We'll turn then to start the webinar proper. We'll go to our panel discussion shortly, but first I'd like them to give them the opportunity of just a quick introduction and to explain what they're going to be covering. Starting with Maria, I'll ask them to introduce themselves. And as I say, starting with Maria. So if you want to open your webcams, and Maria, take it away.
Thank you, Kate. Good morning. I'm a Corporate Finance Director at Grant Thornton, and my work involves advising shareholders, including the private equity community, seeking to build and realize value through merger and acquisition transactions.
Thank you, Kate. Thank you, Kate. Morning. Usman Malik, partner at Grant Thornton, focusing on mergers and acquisitions, similar to Maria, advising shareholders, private equity, PLCs on buy side and sell side transactions, and delighted to be here this morning.
Angela?
Thank you. And I'm Angie Peacock. I'm the Global Director of Diversity and Inclusion across PDT Global and Affirmity. We are an organization that recently Grant Thornton has sold. But the work that I do specializes very much in looking at organizations across the world and looking at the reasons they drive their diversity and inclusion agendas, how that actually adds value to their organization. And we advise both private investors, we also advise PE organizations, and we advise founders as well on this topic.
Lovely. Thanks, Angie. And Tom?
Thanks, Kate. Hi, everyone. I'm Tom Redpath. I'm an Investment Director and Head of Value Creation at Bridges Fund Management. Bridges is a specialist lower mid-market PE fund. We're an impact investor, so we're looking for businesses that have sustainable value created alongside their shareholder value, so environmental or societal impacts alongside creating commercial financial returns.
Lovely. And Raggy?
Hi, I'm Raggy Singh. I'm a corporate partner at international law firm Gowling WLG. I work across most sectors and geographies, albeit I'm responsible for our electric vehicle and automotive practice and our India group. Like Angela, I've acted on all sides of PE transactions, acting for PE houses, founders, and management teams. And delighted to be invited to attend today. Thank you.
Wonderful. So I'll ask you to take your webcams off. I'll keep mine off just for the time being. So I'm going to ask Maria now to set the scene for us and to share what Grant Thornton is hearing from clients.
Thank you, Kate. I think it's a really important topic, particularly in the post-pandemic world and in the context, particularly now we're seeing with the FTSE 100, for example, climbing to 40% above its 2020 low, and equally the FTSE 250 going increasing beyond the pre-COVID levels. That idea of the recovery of those markets and what is driving valuations back and in excess of pre-COVID levels is really relevant for our mid-market clients as well. And we've been considering this concept of redefining value over the past few months in context of the work we're doing, particularly in the M&A market. looking at our activity and the valuations we've seen pre and post pandemic. And what we've been looking to understand is the hallmarks of those businesses which have retained or increased their core value, and how are those different to pre-COVID, and will they reset permanently as we move forward? I think what we know and what we've seen from our client base already and historically is that sustainability of earnings is a key to underpinning value. It's always been the case. And what we're now increasingly seeing our clients considering is other aspects of sustainability, thinking about supply chains with real business risks there. And the examples that we've seen of events like the Ever Given are real examples that we need to think a bit more broadly in terms of sustainability. The workforce and our well-being of employees and the nature of our employees, who are we actually employing now to drive those sustainable earnings, are becoming relevant in our conversations, and then increasing environmental pressures as well. When we're considering presenting a business pre-investment, we are very much looking at those factors beyond the balance sheet and other dynamics, really understanding the markets in which our clients now operate and considering this through this post-COVID lens. And that's why we've really tried to hone this down into a framework for redefining value, looking at those four pillars that are outlined here: skills, data and information, technology, and ESG, environmental, social and governance considerations. What we have found is that this approach really draws out how they drive sustainable earnings, and that truly business models have been tested and are evolving. What we're really now seeing is that business models are emerging that we would not have expected to see 5 years ago, where location is no longer a barrier to accessing global customers, for example. And as you'd expect, technology has been an increasing feature driving business valuation. But increasingly important and on the agenda, and why we have the panel here today, is that the importance of diversity, inclusion and ESG are becoming higher up the agenda, particularly in the context of reporting pressures and stakeholder and consumer expectations. And it's likely to drive even more evolution as we continue to think about these factors and actually how they link to value creation. So what we have undertaken to delve a little bit further and explore what's really important to investors across our client base and what they're now prioritising, we have launched a private equity survey looking at the mid-market private equity funds who are supporting our client base continuing to grow and invest in the mid-market, and sharing some of their thoughts and insight. What are they now prioritising as important to driving value? Has this changed? And particularly exploring the factors of ESG and diversity inclusion within that. So I'm really pleased to be able to talk you through some of the survey content and results today. It is indicative at this stage, but we've had a selection of private equity funds that have contributed so far to this survey, and we'll be producing a more full report in the coming months. So perhaps we can turn to our survey slides now, and this just gives you a flavour of those UK mid-market contributors to date to our survey. Some of these houses are really prioritising the concept of impact investing, which we'll come on to through some of our questions. I think what's really important with the first question that we posed is around, you know, how significant an impact has the pandemic had on the way in which you assess value? And really, as anticipated, mid-market private equity firms all consider that COVID-19 has had an impact in the way in which they're assessing value. And unsurprisingly, with the second question, the resilience and strength of those business models was a key factor in their approach to assessing value now. Second in that list is the underlying earnings and normalisation adjustments. And we see this through our work at Grant Thornton. It has been an increasing discussion point across transactions. How do we now normalise that, that underlying earnings, particularly in the wake of COVID? And that's going to set to continue over the coming years. What we have found is that where the business is able to pivot and show resilience and change in that business model, we have been presenting that in our pro forma adjusted earnings in order to present the business in that future future-proof spotlight. In terms of our next question, it was really interesting to think about the idea of technology and healthcare. So perhaps if we can move on to that slide. We wanted to explore the sectors that private equity felt would attract the highest growth in valuations. It is probably no surprise to our clients that technology and healthcare being at the forefront of the UK PE market in terms of areas that they'd expect to see increased multiples. It's not forgetting, though, that there are other areas here and other sectors. It doesn't mean that they can't drive value within those sectors. You can still differentiate with a change in a business model in financial services or business support services sectors, for example. And I know certainly Usman on our panel today has got some really good examples in the sector he operates in around how those factors are really driving value. So if we move on to the next area and thinking back to our pillars and coming back to our framework that we've set up in order to assess value, it's really interesting that those areas of skills, technology, data and information and ESG are taking up a greater proportion of investors' time now when they're considering and appraising value. But what's really interesting is that when they're considering what their components of their time are split out into, that skills is taking up an increased amount of time compared to where it was 3 years ago and where it's going to be in 3 years' time. But interestingly, technology, data and information and ESG are expected to continue to take up more time in 3 years. I think what's striking here as well, if you draw out the ESG aspect of this, it is well documented and it is an area of focus. And whilst it's continuing to increase, it is still the lowest percentage of time that investors are spending considering their appraisement of value. And I think Tom from Bridges on our panel today has probably got some really helpful views to share with us in respect of what's driving that. So if we think about the ESG agenda specifically, our next set of questions really honed in to the concept of environmental and social and governance agenda and how private equity are tackling this ESG agenda. If we can move on to the next slide, what we can really see here from this question is what is driving the change of private equity in terms of considering ESG. What's really clear is that it's the stakeholder and the limited partners and funds that are looking to invest in those private equity vehicles that are really driving the change. And that our private equity community are finding that their approach to ESG within their portfolios is a differentiator in terms of attracting new investors to a fund. I think what's really interesting is we're probably yet to see an evolution of business owners really demanding that ESG approach with their investors that they choose to work with, which comes through in the split around private equity's view that really it's yet to be a differentiator in terms of their ability to win a competitive process. So I think if we delved a little bit further in terms of our questions and bringing this back to value creation versus risk protection, our next question was looking to really understand if the ESG agenda is seen more of a risk protector or a value creator. So perhaps we can move to that next slide, which really should be able to show those three core aspects of ESG and how the private equity community are really measuring those on in terms of that scale. I think what's interesting here is that the social factors are trending more towards value creation than the other aspects. However, overall, all of these factors are still trending more towards being a risk protector than a value driver. And perhaps that's because we're yet to see the tangible nature of some of those aspects in terms of driving that sustainable profitability. Thinking about measurement, and we always think, how do we actually measure some of these initiatives and how are they driving value in our mid-market businesses? We wanted to really see what our private equity community were in fact measuring in terms of the ESG agenda, which comes through in terms of our next question. So what's clear here is that most respondents are at least measuring a handful of KPIs, with most reporting between 1 and 5 KPIs that they're measuring. What's really interesting here is that of those measures, the employee-linked ones are the most prevalent, which, if we consider the social aspect in our earlier question, might be linked to the recognition that the employee welfare and employee engagement is actually a really great, a much greater value driver currently than perhaps the other factors. So if we think about stakeholder sentiment that is driving the turn of private equity towards some of these environmental, social and governance aspects, we really wanted to see how our private equity community are approaching this and who are they putting forward to represent them in this market, which is where our next question turns to. Despite that stakeholder sentiment driving the agenda for ESG, it is still surprising that less than half of those firms that have responded still don't have a head of ESG within their portfolio. And really, even more surprising, that 65% of them still either don't have a formal ESG policy or still take an ad hoc approach here. So I think what we're seeing is an evolving agenda of ESG in terms of driving value, but we're recognising that it is increasingly important on the agenda because of that stakeholder sentiment. And whilst our results are indicative, it does paint a picture of the increasing focus on those four pillars in terms of investor sentiment in assessing value. And that deal considerations of old are being supplemented by really focused questions being asked around skills, data and information technology and ESG. And the resilience of our business models is still extremely critical for our investors. And then coming back to our ESG perspective, it is evolving, but it's still mixed in approach across our mid-market private equity community. And hopefully, Kate, that sets the scene now for our ongoing panel discussion, which will pick up some of the themes of our survey and explore them in a little bit more detail.
Thank you so much, Maria. And I've been scribbling furiously. It does strike me. I mean, I worked in corporate finance about 100 years ago. And back then, ESG was on the landscape, but it was kind of in that nice to have category. And as I said, it's a very long time ago. So it's very interesting to me that, now I think what we're going to be talking about is how it drives value. And I'm going to bring in Usman on in that regard. But the two points I'm picking up here among many from from the survey, that less than half have appointed a head of ESG and a third still to develop an ESG policy instead of in a formal sense. And my question, and maybe on behalf of some people watching, might be like, really, why should I care about ESG? So I want to hold that thought, because I really want to get underneath what is driving, like, why should I care, basically, which is obviously what we're going to try to answer. But I think if it distills down into that, if we're still not quite getting it, from what you're telling me, we're going to have to get it soon if we are going to see that value creation. So Usman, let's have a look at that in terms of what the survey suggested. How are you seeing technology inclusion, sustainability then impacting on valuations in that regard?
Sure. So, I mean, I think the first thing I would say, Kate, is that many of the trends impacting valuation were in place pre-pandemic. What the pandemic really done is catalyze the pace of change and adoption of those trends. I mean, if we take the features of technology, sustainability and inclusion, they undoubtedly lead to materially higher multiples. We've seen that on the deals that we've been advising over the last 12 months during the pandemic in particular. Technology is undoubtedly a key differentiator. It's a barrier to entry and it's a basis for scalability. And businesses which are data driven, enable more robust decision making, and more importantly, clients are demanding data fundamentally, and that's very important. And if you look at sort of inclusion and sustainability, this is all about longevity in business models and making more rounded and holistic decision making, which again is very important in a global marketplace.
So what's holding people back?
Well, I think some people are still finding their feet in terms of, what does this mean? I know we've got Tom from Bridges on the, on the panel, and Tom and Bridges have been at the forefront of focusing on ESG and as part of their sort of appraisal and investment decision making. There's a clear trend, and it just takes some longer than others in terms of adopting those, investment decisions.
Maria, is it a little bit like trying to turn an oil tanker in that regard?
Yes, I think sometimes it's very difficult to measure the impact of some of these initiatives, and we all know how important it is, and it's becoming important in the consumer psyche as well, driving the agenda. But how we measure and actually quantify some of those initiatives is difficult, but we all know that it really is important to do that.
Before I bring in Tom, just Esmond, just back to your point then, in terms of the multiples, what examples of differential have you got perhaps between the companies that have embraced the tech and those who haven't?
Sure. So one example I like in particular is a transaction that was completed recently for a business called End Clothing. And End Clothing, a business based in the northeast of England, 150 million turnover, online luxury fashion retailer, 30 million EBITDA. 150 million turnover. Carlyle Private Equity have just invested in that business at a multiple of 25 times, which is a phenomenal multiple for the type of business it is compared to some of its competitors. And because of the technology and the online presence and the data-driven model that's adopted, they've been able to access a global customer base and prove to be very resilient during the pandemic. And then if I look at the sort of business services sector and look at more traditional labor-led models, which are pivoting towards technology-led models, and I take the, very simply, the man guarding security sector, which are adopting more managed CCTV type sort of business models. Transaction that we just advised on, which is Themis Risk Holdings, which is replacing, men in a porter cabin with managed CCTV. That business, went for a double-digit EBITDA multiple. There was another business in that market called WCCTV. And also a business in Germany, the Nordics, in that market. And I'll give you a range for the multiples, but they sit between 10 and 20 times EBITDA, because fundamentally they're taking technology, replacing commoditized labor, and it's a very scalable market ultimately. So those would be some of the best examples I can give you of how technology is impacting valuations in the various sectors.
Angela, you're nodding at that. Can you unmute, my lovely?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's interesting when you actually look even in the sectors that you're talking about there, and we're actually advising a particular organisation in that sector. And what they are looking at are huge diversity issues as well. So they've got the technology going, but diversity-wise, they've not. But this is interesting. The clients that they are listing that are clamouring for their services are starting to turn the screws in terms of procurement on what their diversity numbers look like. So in other words, you can do what you like in terms of being fantastic technologically and advanced in terms of your business area. But if your clients are starting to say, I want you reporting on these numbers, then actually how sustainable is your turnover? And there's a big question there that we're giving a lot of advice on at the moment in terms of that. Sorry.
No, not at all. No, it's really interesting, that sort of holistic approach to bear in mind. So we'll come back to that. Just bringing in Tom. Tom, the survey then sort of noting that ESG then one of the increasing factors, compared with 3 years ago in terms of time spent. How do you see ESG and the link with value creation? And I was interested as well, maybe for all of you, that point that Maria made, that it's still seen as more of a risk protection than value creation. So how do we kind of change that? I mean, we've obviously just had some really good examples from Usman there, but just generally speaking.
I think I could probably spend the rest of the panel talking about that survey, about the questions and everything in there, but let me try and be succinct where I can be. I mean, my title is Head of Value Creation, and I'm responsible for the, impact value created, as well as the commercial impact value created. And I think a differentiator of how Bridges works, we see them being interlinked. So by focusing on ESG and impact credentials, you actually create better business outcomes. So if you strip it back, I think ESG has got badged very in a nebulous way, and everyone's kind of forgot what it's about. So you talk about ESG and you think corporate social responsibility, you're probably going to do a volunteering exercise on a Friday afternoon and everyone feels great about it, but it's completely detached from what your business is. That's actually not what it is. It's a fundamental principle. It's good investing. So it talks about environmental, social and governance issues. Now, we've all just come through an absolutely horrific 12 months, I'm sure, being, you know, worrying about businesses and taking them on. Businesses that I have that perform the best are the ones that have the best governance in place. You know, they knew how to react. They had a way to deliver strategy. If you need to be agile, it's actually the governance part of ESG that allows you to do that. It's not, let's see how we get on. So you know what to do in terms of business continuity plan. You know what to do in terms of employees are suffering from COVID. How are you going to work remotely? That all comes down to governance. It's not just the nice thing to do. It's just how a business works really well. Now, some of the aspects have been a bit temporary. You know, we were all really focused on probably heightened communication. You know, it was daily, wasn't it, when Boris had changed his mind every second day. And we had regular comms with all of our portfolio. But it's then sort of evolved to say, that's crisis management, ESG. More sustainable part is, for me, always on social. And it was interesting on the survey, the most important area was social and people. Now, if you forget about ESG for a second, if I just talked to you about people and the management teams, everyone on this call, right, will know, get a really good team together and you like achieve wonderful things. Have a really engaged employee base that will do more for you. Employee attrition is low. That's great. If I'm buying a business, I don't want to see something that's 50% turnover, because I know it's just hard work to keep it going. So for me, if you focus on the right areas of ESG, it's really powerful. And like with all strategy, it's not about doing 20 things really a bit poorly. It's about choosing the 2 to 3 things that make a real difference in driving your business forward. And I guess for everyone on the call, it doesn't have to be changing the world, but I've not found a business where focusing on making it more enjoyable place to work hasn't created more value for that business, and it makes it better to sell later down the line. So if you're thinking about, you know, dipping your toes in the ESG, just get like a rewards platform or engage with your staff more frequently and you'll have wonderful returns. But I think for me and for Bridges, it's always about the output. Like, why are you doing it? We're not doing ESG just because it feels like a nice thing to do and we all pat ourselves on the back. We're doing it because we think it creates more value and makes a better business and makes it more resilient. And, you know, a core investment principle for everyone is driving multiple higher, right? If I've got two companies side by side that look exactly the same, talk exactly the same way, but one is really focusing on ESG and people are proud to work there, it makes everything so much easier. So I guess I actually do see it as a huge differentiator when you get it and you understand it well. If you see it as an adjunct to what you do, it's like, oh, we'll do a volunteering hour. It's nonsense. It doesn't help.
And you're not going to be able to hide anymore, because the reporting requirements are going to really expose what is and isn't being done.
They are. And you saw it with the LPs. They're demanding more. Well, we get very high demands from some of our investors on exactly what we do. But even our stakeholders care. So we've got a business called the Impact Food Group. It does school catering, tried to do what, well, does what Jamie Oliver tried to do 10 years ago, really good healthy school food. We provide impact reports to our schools, so they know how many students have eaten, how much fat we've saved compared to other caterers. And it just resonates. You know, everyone wants to see what you're doing and why it makes a difference. So I think one of the things that I think Angela is going to talk about, which I think is spot on, is diversity, which is another kind of fundamental pillar of what we talk about in ESG. It's really hard. If you get diverse perspectives that are relevant to solving a problem, you get much better outcomes. So I'd kind of, you know, close it with ESG gets banded in so many different ways, but if you do it well, you're just creating a better business. It's a good thing to do, not a thing you feel like you should have to do.
I'm going to bring in Angela next, but just before, Usman, Raggy, anything you want to add to what Tom has just said before? I'm going to come to you, Raggy, as well, but anything supplementary on in that regard?
Just a quite topical story in my own market, also in legal services, and resonating with what Angela said about clients demanding it. So Coca-Cola have told us that unless we meet their ESG practices, 15% off the fees. And BT have said that we'll automatically get renewed to the panel if over the next 3 years we meet BT's ESG targets. So it's automatic renewal of a long-term contract. So you know, whether you like it or not, our clients and customers will start making this more of an issue.
And what exactly, are they specific about what they're demanding? Because it's quite a broad spectrum, as we've been hearing. So what are they actually demanding?
Yeah, there is some detail in there. I haven't led the panel bid, but I think it'll be similar to, I mean, Microsoft did it to us in 2008. They said, you know, you have to show a 2% or a 0.5, 2% improvement in your diversity as a firm, or 0.5% within the team delivering the actual work. So it's been around for a little while, but it is certainly under the lens of our CFO.
I'm laughing because we probably advised them at that point. So I mean, when you look at this, though, it kind of falls into different areas. So if I pick up from what Raggy's saying there, if you just look at diversity alone, and I'm running a bit of a one woman campaign with ESG, by the way, that I think diversity needs to come out and separate it. I think we in terms of the research that we saw, I'd like to have seen that separated a little bit more. But if you look at diversity alone, it's one of those self-fulfilling prophecies. So what Raggy's saying is absolutely true. There are organizations saying, you know, thou shalt meet our ESG requirements, but actually there are more out there to some of the organizations that we're looking to acquire that are actually turning the screws hugely in a big way, specifically in terms of the diversity numbers. So if we separate just for a second what diversity is from what inclusion is, because I do think that's important when we're looking at this as well, both from the buy side and the sell side. When you're looking at diversity numbers, you are purely looking at what does it actually look like in terms, it's typically gender and race that gets asked about at the moment, although other categories of diversity are starting to be asked. And what I would be doing, and what we're advising organisations to do, is to start to look at who the big clients are that those organisations have got, and start to look at what they are requiring. Because if the organisation you are buying is perfect in every way, except for the fact that its big client is Microsoft, and they are going to be asking you not just to represent your gender numbers, but to actually tell me where they are sitting in your organisation, and you've got a bunch of founders at the top that are all straight white guys, you're going to have a problem pretty soon coming down the line, and that is speeding up. So we start by looking at that. But if we look a bit more broadly at what we do, the organisations that we're advising, certainly the PE organisations we're advising, tend to fall into two camps. We have got some, and I will give you, they tend to be the global ones, that are currently sending us in pre-buying. So we are actually helping them do due diligence in that we're doing a diversity report, an assessment on the organisation. It is rare that we're asked to do an inclusion report at that stage. And by inclusion, we're talking about creating an environment in which diversity can thrive. So arguably, you don't get one without the other anyway. However, we have other organisations that we're working with that basically on acquisition are blanketly sending us in to do a diversity and inclusion assessment straight off, and the organisations that they are acquiring are having to go through a certain level of programme and commit to doing some specific change, making some specific changes. Interestingly, within that, where we go in and we are seen as just another HR piece that, you know, the investment firm is kind of saying you will fall in line with our HR policies, it's harder work. Where we're seen as strategic and we plug straight into the CEO and we're advising there, much better deal, much quicker changes, we can actually make a difference. So from that perspective, we've got some that are making it optional and some that are sending us in, and we are compulsory once they've acquired.
And the compulsory element, do you think, is driven by the fact that they understand, and I'd like you to give me the evidence on this, that more diverse organisations do actually produce better results?
Yeah, I think it's twofold. I think they understand that. I think, if I'm going to be brutal, they also want to be seen to be doing it, in, as we heard before, you know, in terms of their investors, they, you know, and stakeholders, they want to be seen to be, look, we're doing this, therefore. I think that's important. But I think they also want to be sure they do see that there is that return. Now, if we want evidence for that, I can give you piles and piles. And I think within that evidence, it's quite interesting. It was 2004 that Catalyst first proved that if you have 32% of women in the top three ranks of any organisation, you will get a better fiscal result. And every single piece of research on pure diversity that has been done since then proves that organisations are improved by having diverse humans within them.
Why is that?
On many, many different levels. You can go for the classic, which we've all heard probably and got bored with. There's more creativity and there's more problem solving when we have that diversity of humanity. I actually prefer the pieces of research that are more specific than that. So they actually speak to, with a diversity of experience, you are more likely to get a diversity of view, which means things like risk assessment is actually more likely to succeed. However, the rider I'll put on that is you can throw diversity at it. If you haven't got an inclusive environment, they're not going to speak up anyway in a risk assessment meeting. So, you know, the two things work together there. It isn't purely having red, yellow, black, white, gay, straight and women sitting around your board table. It is having the right environment and lack of toxicity around the outside of that. But if you look at it, risk assessment has been proven. The other thing that makes sense to me, weirdly, is governance and compliance. Again, higher rates of governance and compliance in these highly diverse organisations, and frankly, more sales, better customer engagement. You know, it's an interesting thing to me. And again, some of the advice we are giving to these organisations is when you are looking to value create and you are looking at the longevity of your value creation and you are looking at the buckets of customers that that client is currently working with, there will be three buckets. There will be the bucket that wants to be dealt with by people that are currently at work in that client group. Let's call them straight white guys for the time being, wearing chinos, middle-aged, knocking on doors. You will have another bucket of clients that also want to be faced off to by someone that reminds them of themselves. So, okay, we'll throw in a few gay people. We'll make sure there's a bit of a race mix there. We'll have some funky people. We'll have some funky people with long hair, Tom, going out, but we will appeal, right? But the scary one that I actually do advise we look at a lot is who's in the last bucket. And the last bucket is, I don't give a flying damn what you look like. And the more technology drives this, the more that bucket increases. And it's, what does that look like in the next? It's even 2 years. It's not even past that. And therefore, what do you need in terms of diversity to appeal to that?
And on that, I'd like to just take a pause. And for everyone watching, I would like to understand, A, I'd like to get a sense of temperature in terms of what's been said. If there's any resistance, what is it? And, you know, we all know, I can see why you're so busy, Angela, because I can imagine people going, gee, I've got enough going on without now trying to get into the nuts and bolts of all of this. I can understand there's a resistance to change. Sometimes we just don't know where to begin. And, you know, so I'd like to ask everybody watching, could you please let us know, because this is your opportunity to do it. You've got these great minds and experience here. What are the biggest challenges that you see? You know, you might want to be creating a more holistic approach in terms of ESG, but maybe you're struggling with something. What is it? What are the biggest challenges and where's the resistance coming from? And I've got lots of other questions for you, but I'm going to just bring in Raggy on this. I just wonder, do we think that investors are, you know, the focus now, the legal focus, let's put it like that, that the legal focus on ESG is something that's here and now, and it's just, yeah, we're going to do it, but it will actually plateau? Or do you think it's going to have an upward trajectory and we are just all going to be there in not too long a distant future?
Look, I think we are partway through the ESG boom. So they're, by definition, if you're partway through a hockey stick curve, then there will be some slowing down of the attention it gets. But I still think there's room for there's still massive room for additional focus. And why do I say that? Well, look, I'm not an expert in all of the ESG and governance related legislation, but what I do know is that the amount of regulation has and will continue to increase. And this all started with, you know, modern slavery statements and gender pay gap reporting on your website. And then the pension regulator got involved and trustees had to pay more attention to ESG. But then you had the weights principles, which was a framework to help large private companies adhere to governance principles, which then became enshrined in law through the company miscellaneous reporting regs, under which you have to report through your director's report and strategic reports on what is your employee engagement. When you make any decision at board level, did you consider what's called the Section 172 factors? Gosh, I sound like a lawyer. Did you consider the environment? Did you consider your customers, your suppliers, your employees? Europe is looking at ESG on steroids. In early March, they brought in the sustainable finance disclosure regs, which are not part of English law at the moment, but under that regulation, funds will be classified based on how sustainable their investments are. There's talk in Europe at the end of this year that if you want to sell into Europe and you're a company of a certain size, you will have to do human rights due diligence on your supply chain. Now, that's going to affect us. We're all going to be still selling into Europe. Our own FCA is consulting, and I think we're helping with it, is consulting with the market to see, should FCA regulated entities be mandated to report to the FCA on what they're doing around ESG. And then you've got, then you throw in banks and credit score rating agencies who have always looked at ESG risk when deciding to lend or give you a credit rating. And I don't think ESG is going to run out of steam anytime soon. But it's, there's plenty of reason why we'll continue. And I think we'll just see more policies, more training, because the likes of Tom and the portfolio companies that he has will want to be ahead of the ESG curve before they're forced to change, either by law or hurriedly before exit, because everyone wants a good ESG story on exit.
It's interesting what you say there about the marked difference between the domestic and overseas PE houses. I mean, Angela, are you seeing that as well? Excuse me.
Yes, I am, but maybe not to that extent. And partly, I think, because the overseas PE houses that we're dealing with are much larger, and therefore they are a lot more controlling and perhaps able to be a lot more controlling. Whereas the ones that are more domestic, the ones that are more domestic are kind of having us go in, but it's not as controlled. It's not as, certainly not mandatory. It's an optional.
Our USP clients seem to be more on it than most. I think that's because, for me, some of this started with BlackRock being sued by 9,000 nuns. You're not sustainably investing at pension. So, and then BlackRock came out and said, well, we'll vote against our directors if they don't take decisions based on sound ESG principles. And they actually named and shamed their own portfolio companies, which I'm waiting for the litigation now from their investors to say, well, you trashed our own investments. So the US do seem to be more on it. Actually, you see a marked difference the other way in Mike's class. We act for the ones from the emerging economies probably don't even have ESG on the radar. It's not even a thing for them. And I think in our line of work, the key differentiator around how much attention it gets, domestic versus overseas PEs, is actually driven by the territory in which the portfolio company operates and the sector. So we do a lot of mining and resources. So ESG is, whether it's domestic or overseas PE, ESG is important. And then if the portfolio company operates in an emerging economy, take Africa, you get more than the PDT Global ESG DD report warranted by the management team. You go two or three steps further and you'll have, within the investment agreement, an investment code and an ESG investment code that the company has to adhere to, mandatory annual audit by third party ESG auditors, and a dedicated ESG officer. So that is the extreme that you do, we are seeing. But I think that's driven more by territory and sector on the origin of the PE house itself.
Yeah, you're nodding, isn't it?
Yeah, and no, I agree with Raggy. I mean, there's a direction of travel in terms of all of the sort of features that we're talking about, you know, in terms of technology, data, diversity and inclusion, and it's an increasing focus in the transactions that I'm advising on. You know, certainly diligence is more focused on those areas than it ever has been before, and all of these features fundamentally, you know, go to the heart of developing sustainable business models which are sticky and future proof, and all of those, you know, everything we've talked about is even more prevalent, you know, in the pandemic or in the uncertain world that we find ourselves in today.
Okay, and we've got lovely lot. If I'm looking up and down, I'm juggling questions coming in and making notes and everything. So I've got good questions coming in from those of you watching. So I'm going to pick up on those. But just to come back to Tom, in terms of those key actions then that you're asking of your management teams post-pandemic, then in terms of driving value, what would they be? And perhaps that's a question you can all come in on just while I'm going to start looking at some of these questions coming in. But the key actions that you're asking.
Classic consultant answer, but it varies. I think some of the commonality is actually being very focused on what is your plan and being structured in delivering strategic objectives. So not being entrepreneurial and reacting as things come in, you know, it's thinking proactively and talking about what changes you're going to make, what plans you want to have in place, what you're going to do about people and engagement. And I think what's been really good about COVID is we've been through a benign market in most sectors. You know, everything was growing, it's kind of fine. And then everyone got punched in the face and you had to kind of rip up your business model and start again. And doing that, you know, 2 a.m. when you've just had a very stressful day of speaking to all of your staff or your clients, or are we going to keep the lights on? I think it's taught a lot of people that having a plan, even if you're going to change it, is a much better place to be than trying to figure it out as you go along. So I think, you know, the long-term focus that we've added are strategic plans, but also financial resilience plans. So, you know, have we got a really good relationship with our banks? Have we got, you know, a strong balance sheet? I think quite a lot of private equity, we run stuff quite lean and you keep cash recycling. Actually, you've seen when it's uncertain, having a little bit of extra cash, not a bad place to be. So yeah, I think that's, to be honest, it's get a plan in place and decide what's really important for your business. That's what I've demanded of all our portfolio companies.
Anyone else want to pick up before I throw a few questions in, Angela?
Yeah, I mean, I can only really echo what Tom said, but I mean, in terms of a plan, and I'd pull the D&I part out, again, having that plan in place, or at least putting it in place at the point you know that the acquisition is coming, and making sure it's a 2-year plan, but knowing what your end in mind is, not just doing it for the sake of doing it because it is driving your business strategy. And I think the other word to throw in there is it is building resilience into your business strategy. So, you know, it's a place to drive to, as we saw in the research there, you know, it's a bit painful when you're doing it to avoid risk. This work is always better when you are doing it to drive and add value. But again, it's the plan. It's exactly what Tom said. I want to see it written down and what the goalposts are.
Is there an element, and I'm saying, I'm going to word this very carefully, but, you know, there is that saying that you cannot solve a problem with the same mindset that created it. And I'm not saying that people have created this problem, but sometimes it's quite difficult to know what to do when we've been doing something the same way, you know, all the time. So I'm just wondering, when we are talking about leadership, if that leadership is finding itself under a lot of pressure right now from every quarter, that resilience is kind of in quite short supply, and thinking ahead and having another thing to think about is actually a challenge in itself. Do you know, see what I'm getting at in terms of the sort of psychology of it? Listen, really help me out here. But I mean,
it's interesting in terms of, sort of, you know, I think what the pandemic's demonstrated is, you know, what should businesses be focusing on, management teams be focusing on? It's about ability to be agile. So, you know, I just look at the supermarkets and, you know,
even my mum and dad, who are in the early 80s, are now shopping online, and this ability of the supermarkets to pivot to demand and do home shopping, you know, home deliveries. You look at businesses which are minimizing their fixed cost base going forward. You know, will businesses be, you know, will there be more co-working to supplement, you know, offices at the moment, and how does that impact culture, inclusion and you know, going forward? And then also, should structures be changed? You know, should management incentive plans be based on different metrics? So I think all of these, you know, these thoughts come to mind in terms of where we are today and post-pandemic.
Kate, can I come in on this?
Yeah, please.
I actually think this is a bit of a plug for investing generally, but having been a strategy consultant, having been an investor, I think when you have greater challenges, you just try and survive the day to day. There's no one there to take you out of the day to day and be thinking about the longer term plan. And actually, I'd be terrible in a business to try to run it or do anything. That's why there's an executive team there. What I'm there to do is coach and ask questions and say, have you thought about this? Because this is what I need to be thinking about. And can I help you solve that problem? And just giving, I guess, back to Angela, which I totally agree with, it's diversity on a problem. So if you've got relevance to the issue you're trying to solve and you've got collective experience, you get to a better answer. So what you're trying to do at the moment is just facilitate the right kind of question to get to the right answer. And I think I'm a big proponent of strategy days. I would be, right? It's paid my salary for some time. You need to step back from the day to day. Otherwise, you can take a load of good intention decisions and you've just siloed your business or got caught in a cul-de-sac. Take a step back and say, where do we need to be? Then what the foundations need to put in place. So it's always that, you know, where are you going to? Where are you today? And balancing the two.
And actually, Tommy, if I can just build on that, that is where an awful lot of both the PE companies and the organisations that they're acquiring go wrong. Because what they do is they think, well, OK, we've hired the diversity girly for 2 hours. She'll come in, she'll wave her magic wand, she'll give us a little bit of a lecture and smack us a bit, and then it'll all be OK. To Tom's point, if you cannot see what the business drivers are for doing this and you don't see it built in, hardwired into your strategy, then any plan you put in is actually fairly superficial and it's just tick box and it's not going to work and you might as well not bother doing it. So yeah, we always know the ones that are going to take it seriously and they're the ones that come in and say, come and do a day, rather than, you know, show up and do a spectacular speech for an hour. So yeah, you absolutely, you've got to take it seriously.
All right, so I'm going to just bring in some of our audience questions now. So anyone can pick up on this while I'm looking at them. Has ESG now overtaken CSR? Who wants
yes.
that?
I think ESG is probably the evolution of CSR, and CSR now just becomes a component part of your ESG plans and strategies. I think what I was talking about earlier with CSR is often not necessarily linked to your business model. And so it does become an additional thing to think about rather than something that's driving your core business to be better. So I actually think CSR is probably best left to the mega organizations that have entire departments that can handle that kind of world. Whereas at the mid-market and when you're a growing organization, you should focus more on the things that are driving your core business model. That's the distinction I'd have on the two.
Angela?
Yeah, I'd say the same thing. Making sure that you've got different people. We don't want the well-being person, the CSR person, and the diversity inclusion person to be the same human. They are completely different needs and completely different brains. So yeah.
Brilliant. What do you see as the challenges over the next 12 months? Let's start with Usman on that one. I'm going to just quickly go through all of you for that.
Sure. From an investor perspective, I think when you're looking at businesses, the real challenge will be what is the sustainable underlying earnings of the business, given the pandemic we've been through. There are businesses that have seen a COVID bounce. There are businesses who've been impacted by COVID, businesses have taken government assistance. So I think getting to grips with the sustainable sustainable underlying performance of the business from an investor perspective will be the key challenge.
Raggy?
I think implementing your good intentions. For example, I've got a number of clients who have the right intention but struggle to recruit and find, for various reasons, the right people. So, the corporate finance community is one where I know that they are trying to address the imbalance between the number of women at the top of that profession versus men. But I know how hard it is from working with some of them to find the right candidates, and those candidates are scarce and in demand. So I think there needs to be an understanding that this has to be a gradual process. Whilst it's at the forefront of everyone's mind, actually implementing the initiatives, it can actually be just quite difficult.
And how do we go about overcoming that then, Angela?
I'm going to breathe really deeply, Maggie, because I could so take you on that one.
Let's hear that. Can I just say, Rob, before, just to give us a pause, Maria, if you want to come...
I'll tell you straight, they're scarce and in demand because you're looking in the wrong damn place. There are lots of ways. We need to turn the screws on the recruitment firms. We need to do all sorts of things. So if you want to send any of them my way to have a chat, Raggy, I'll damn well help them find senior women that are quite capable of finance. I think what is interesting is the assumptions that we make based on the comfort factor that we've got. So for most of finance that we are talking about here today, it is run by a lot of people that are very comfortable with each other, and they always have been. And actually, we know that the unconscious mind works very well when it feels comfortable. And when you're being forced to work with somebody that doesn't walk like you, speak like you, think like you, and maybe buy like you, you don't quite see it. I mean, dear God, I saw that myself with our interaction, shall we say, with PE companies when we were selling. I can't tell you how many people were patting me on the head and asking me what handbag I would buy once I'd sold my business. And I am not joking about that. But if I answer your first question, which was, next 12 months, what I think is this, and I'm going back and building on what this mum was really saying, the sustainability is important. We've seen who's resilient and who's not during COVID. The sustainability part, that making sure that the underlying finances are strong. But I also think it's really waking up to what the forces are that are going to drive diversity and possibly damage your business, and whether that's a coffee shop or whether that's the security firm that we were talking about earlier. Within COVID, we have seen George Floyd's murder, we've seen the rise of BLM, we've seen the Asian violence. We know that this is going to be front and center of customers, and I'm talking bottom of the food chain customers, whether that's B2B or B2C, all over the place. And that is going to impact what we do. So I think it's no good just saying, look, this company's been resilient during lockdown, if their diversity numbers are trash, because within a year, you are going to see their brand dragged through the streets if they don't do something pretty fast. So for me, there's a good conversation there too.
Maria,
that's a challenge there, isn't it? That there will be a time, like, there are definitely sectors and industries which haven't been diverse enough, so the senior talent just isn't there in the numbers that the demand is there. So if you've got every manufacturing business or corporate finance house or law firm seeking to do the right thing, but you've got a gender drag from years of lack of diversity, I think there, I think in the next, because everyone's alive to this issue. I mean, we've just made up, what has been announced, 90% of our new partners this year, and it's the largest partner intake, are on merit female. But I think the law has actually got a greater pool to pick from than if you want to, if you're in an automotive manufacturing plant, which has been so male dominated for decades that you've got a handful of senior women in engineering, and that needs to change and is changing, but it's not going to happen in 6 months. So
it's not,
it's the recruiters who are coming back to these clients of mine and saying, well, three for you to pick from, and one lives in Scotland, one lives in Dover, and you're in Wales.
I mean, I'll,
so that's Raggy, the challenge.
I can give you the quick answer on that. You tell these recruiters and search agencies that you are putting them under the microscope for the next 3 years, and what, or year rather, and what you are going to do is you are looking at the diverse candidates you hire from them, not these damn diverse slates, because they're a waste of time. How many diverse candidates you are going to hire from them, you will find miraculously they suddenly find all these women that have been hiding under stones for a while. So I do understand it's not as easy as that, but I can tell you there are ways and means, and I'm very happy to share them.
All right. Who's that, Maria?
I was just going to add to that. I think what we're talking about here is a labour market reset, and the way in which we work is going to help drive that. So one of the things that I've been thinking about to your question, Kate, around challenges over the next 12 months is actually as we see employees looking to work differently and how we then bridge that going back into offices to a degree, that will throw up a whole new set of workers that we can then look to have within our businesses. And I think that's really relevant for what we're seeing our clients are doing. And then how do we bridge that gap of digital face-to-face as we come back and emerge from COVID? I think that's actually going to be a really big challenge about how we come back together.
Question for Tom, is there a greater cost to making investment now given all the regulation and these factors?
Sorry, just run that again, Kate.
Is there a greater cost to making investment now given all the regulation and these factors that we've been discussing?
Yeah, Usman keeps putting his fees up. It's absolutely incredible. I can't take it. So there is a greater cost, but there's a better return. So I guess my philosophy is when you come into diligence and you try and appraise an asset, you get sort of one opportunity where everyone's open to like exploring what the business looks like, finding issues. And the greatest impact on returns is time, right? So we're all trying to invest on a 3 to 5 year window. If I wait 2 years for an issue that's right beneath the surface to bubble up and then explode and then erode all that value, I need to push a management team to deliver 50, 60, 70, 100% growth, right? And you'll go back and say, oh, I wish I'd spent that, I don't know, 10 grand or whatever it might have been to just know where you stand at the start. And it's really important that you then build, I guess, working relationships on how we're going to solve that, because it's not an issue if you start and build it over time. It becomes an issue if you change how you do stuff somewhere through the investment cycle. Like, I'm sure everyone can resonate with wanting to do something differently and trying to move all the stakeholders, you know, maybe 20 meetings to get someone to agree to something. Spend it at diligence, and I don't think it's really increased that dramatically. Just don't go overboard. Choose the one that's most important, most valuable.
There are questions coming in now, one of which are along the same theme. Is ESG merely a bureaucracy overload that will ultimately stifle growth? And there's been a few along those lines. It's just that it just seems, I think I'm getting the sense of, for some people, it just feels like, right now it can end up kind of stifling our growth rather than creating value.
I agree, actually, in certain areas. If you do this really poorly, it's terrible. So, like any strategy, do 3 to 5 things really, really well. Like, it's the same principles as if you're growing your business. Find the things that make a difference and focus on them. If you do ESG terribly, you're stuffed because you spend all this time chasing stuff that doesn't matter or is irrelevant to your like business. You know, like
top three things then, Tom, for people that you would say
to focus on or not to do.
Both, but I'd like to focus on something positive. Let's give us three things to focus on. I'm going to throw this as the last question when we do come to it, but just the practical end, the top three things.
So governance, and by virtue of what way you're going to deliver strategy and execute strategy within your organization. So set objectives and key results and hold people to account. It'll drive an entire performance culture of your business and you'll know what's going on. That'd be number one, because that sets everything else. The second area that I'd focus on is employee engagement, like doing everything you possibly can to make sure employees are engaged. Things like, not to plug specific companies, but Reward Gateway, CultureAmp, perk boxes, all these other things that provide benefits and additional services to employees for pretty low cost. And then the third thing that I'd recommend for what it's worth is communication. It's a bit wishy-washy, but just communicating openly and consistently with your employees and your external stakeholders on what you're doing. It just creates opportunities for, I guess, engagement with clients and external. I'd focus there first. It works in every business.
I mean, there's a few things on that. So one, all the advisors or major advisors on the globe can't be getting it wrong. We've got a specialist governance and ESG team that we've invested in. So they must be adding value somewhere to these businesses, or they won't pay us for that service. Two, I think what's at the heart of ESG has been there in terms of good business decisions for decades. You know, environmental and other compliance, we've always looked at that as a law firm. Governance structures, we've always looked at that. You know, are the right people making the right decisions? And employee pay, grievances, policies, and engagement. We've been looking at that. We've been due diligencing that since time immemorial. So what's at the heart of ESG has always been there. You know, we've talked about empirical data. Angela said that, you know, it's been proven to lead to better decision-making, more resilient businesses. But look forwards. You know, look at my daughters and you know, the businesses they're going to want to work for in the future, the products they're going to want to buy. I'm client partner for BMW, and they know that the people who will be buying their cars in the future aren't us. You know, they're looking at the millennials and how will they make their buying decisions. And ESG is key. If you haven't got ESG on your website, people will click through. And you know, Deliveroo, Boohoo, Carillion, you couldn't have three better examples of why this matters. And ultimately, if you're talking about PE, you know, PE are all about best practice. ESG is seen as best practice now, and that is what PE do, and that is what they place value on.
And there is a question that's in. Someone's asked, are we overcomplicating value creation here?
Again, you can overcomplicate value creation if you don't know what you're doing. And I'll say this until I'm blue in the face, like advising Unilever on their global strategy or on 1 million EBITDA business is the same principle. You choose a few things to do really, really well, find your niche and deliver against them. Like, don't try and do tons, right? And value creation, EBITDA growth, multiple growth, generating cash. If you cannot tie an activity or an objective to improving those like metrics, don't waste your time with it. Like, everything we've talked about today, for me, actually contributes to creating those things when you do it well. If you do it poorly, like everything else, it's absolutely a waste of time. Sorry, it just says.
And if I can build on that, one of my words that I've always say at the end of these things is, you know, make sure that your individuals in your organisation can draw a line between why they are creating an inclusive environment and driving diversity, and your business outcomes ultimately, but their business objectives in the middle of that. Because quite honestly, if you're sitting down here and actually you're just hearing these grandstanding statements around creativity and problem solving up here, you're not really understanding what it means or why you're doing it. It's completely irrelevant. We want to know, you know, we're going to move into this market. It's going to be easier if we've got people that are different to us. We're going to develop this product. This specific service is going to improve. Make sure that we are articulating what that looks like. But it's got to be linked to the bigger picture. We don't just do it for fun.
Thank you. So, look, as we draw to a close, I'm going to hand the floor back to Maria. But before I do, one last question that's in that I think I'd like each of you just to answer. And then, Maria, if you'd like to pick up and take it away. I think I'm just going to add that there is a recording that will be shared following the event. So before then, we do our final thanks. What is, for the audience listening and from your perspective, what is the one thing you think they should go back and talk to their business about? Let's start with Usman.
I think for me, it would be agility. How are we going to be more agile in the next 12, 18 months, you know, even 3 years? I think that would be the key for me.
Angela?
For me, it's very much talking to your business about diversity, inclusion and equity as three different things. Having a conversation that says, let's assess where we are at all of those, preferably a measurement at all of those, and then looking at how we're going to build the changes that we need to build to drive them to add that value.
Tom.
I'd actually take the time to reconnect with your team. We've all been working remotely for a very long time, and I'm seeing a lot of fractures in my management teams because they're not spending time together. So, you know, spend a couple of days together when you can, even if you're just in the pub, and just talk about what you want to achieve with your business. I think it'll achieve a lot more than trying to do remote board meetings, to be honest. So that'd be one bit of advice.
Lovely. Raggy.
Well, it's the theme on what Tom's just said. I think during the pandemic, that gel that's kept us all together has been eroded through time, and we're all keen to get in the office again to reconnect and create that. And therefore, I think in terms of retention of your key staff and recruiting new members, you're going to have something different about you, because location is no longer a barrier to moving job. And so what is it about that firm that makes them stay? Because you can't keep throwing money at people. And also, it's not all about the money anymore. People want to work for an organisation with a social purpose that they feel good about. And we did a survey, we did a quarterly survey for the pandemic to keep our finger on the pulse and tick the employee engagement box. But it was interesting that people wanted to feel proud of working for Gowling and what we'd done coming out of the pandemic.
Really nice. And Maria, I'll ask you the same question and then ask you to take it away.
Okay, thanks, Kate. I think the way I think about this is the markets that our clients are operating in have changed vastly. And so when you get back into the office with your teams, it's about doing that gap analysis, using our key pillar framework to help you do that, and actually consider what you should continue doing now and what you should stop doing now. As we start to, I suppose, launch into that, hopefully, post-COVID recovery. And so, yeah, thinking about that, and there has been a huge amount of content that we've covered here today, what we'd like to ask our clients and those listening is, if anything has resonated with you, that we're here to continue that conversation, answer any questions you have after this webinar closes. And so please do get in contact with those people that I think there's a slide here with our contact details, which hopefully will be helpful, Kate.
Lovely, I'm sure it will. Well, that just leaves me to say thank you to our panel today, Usman, Tom, Angela, Raggy, and to you, Maria. Thank you very much indeed to those of you who've been watching. And I hope we can maybe take a bit of time now just to go and enjoy the sunshine, decompress a little bit. And thank you for all your thoughts. I've really enjoyed it. Thank you very much indeed.